This is your gold, silver, and Bitcoin market updates for the very dramatic year of 2020. This video will explore some of the key changes that we've seen over the last year, which have been absolutely colossal. I'm Miles Harris, and this channel provides global macro insights and champions the importance of sound money in a world gone crazy. So please do consider subscribing. Now let's firstly start with the gold and silver prices over the course of 2020, where we've seen gold up almost 25% on the year so far, silver up almost 45%, with those March lows of $1,472 for gold and $12.01 for silver. Meanwhile, we can see the highs that were retained back in the summer. This year has been the year with which central banks have really tried to grab the bull by the horns and take hold of the market to direct it exactly where they want. As a consequence, we can see exactly where the Fed's balance sheet has gone from the end of 2019. Meanwhile, the monetization of the fiscal deficit, which has absolutely skyrocketed, as we can see since the end of 2019, and commensurate with that, the national debt has also increased markedly. This has taken place at the same time by which the DXY dollar index has continued to weaken. Now, it's really when we actually look at the fiscal deficit as a chart that we can really see the colossal difference that has taken place over the course of this last year. Just look at this. This is absolutely enormous. And so this is, of course, feeding a growing rise in the national debt, which is evident here and is evident throughout the whole of the Western world, as well as in emerging markets. This CNBC article shows us just that. The attack of the debt tsunami as coronavirus pushes global debt to a record high. And we can see here that the advanced nations debt has surged above 432% of GDP in the third quarter of 2020, a 50 percentage points increase from 2019. Meanwhile, emerging markets debt levels have risen to over 248% of GDP. And we can see that a number of countries have experienced significant problems over the course of this year, most notably the Lebanon and Argentina. Now, this excellent chart from the Visual Capitalist highlights the extent of the changes in debt to GDP for households in blue, non-financial corporations in turquoise, and governments in green. Now, all credit to the Aussies here who have really tried to target their household debts and have really tackled those debts aggressively, as we can see down here. Now, the impact on the M1 money supply, that is the most liquid money, which has absolutely rocketed over the course of 2020. Meanwhile, the broader M2 money supply has also increased notably, as we can see here. Now, this one's often used by economists to actually highlight the likelihood of future inflation expectations. And we can see there's such a dramatic increase here is absolutely significant. The big question is, will we still see this filter through to wider price growth? Well, my take on this is ultimately that we're already seeing this through a biflationary mechanism where we're seeing deflation among consumer discretionaries and we're seeing inflation among consumer necessities. And so a big theme of the years to come is that central banks' balance sheets are going to continue to rise, just as we can see here. And this is absolutely significant. It's also worth just noting that when it comes to the Chinese central bank, it is not increasing its balance sheet at the same rate by which other Western central banks are, and that's significant. Now, treasuries did particularly well in quarter one of 2020 and have since largely flatlined as markets went risk on after the liquidity was injected by the Fed. Oil has had a far more turbulent year, where the price has come under renewed price pressure as a result of recent as a result of the introduction of more recent lockdowns, as well as discussion of mutant coronaviruses. And so looking at the gold chart, we can see that gold has managed to maintain support above 1860 over the course of the last week, and is currently priced at 1878. Now, it would be great to see gold really burst through around 1920 to really identify that next level of support. And that's obviously key resistance here for gold. But it looks a little way from a breakout just yet. Meanwhile, for silver, well, silver continues to demonstrate that same strength that we've seen recently from the white metal. We can see that double bottom. We can also see that closing above that price level of $26 would appear to be significant and would really set a new level of support for silver. But with the prospect of more stimulus to come, it seems highly plausible that silver is ready to go. And just to confirm this, we can see the movement on the gold-silver ratio here, where it's broken that support level of around about 76. And we can see it's just flirting with much lower levels now. As for the risk sentiment here, well, we can see that over the course of the last month, the market has really taken on a risk-on approach. But over the course of the last week, there's clearly that much more uncertainty to be found. The reason being, of course, is the recent introduction of lockdowns and increased case numbers, as well as concerns over this new strain of virus. Nevertheless, I really do expect this risk-on approach to maintain, particularly if it's accompanied by further central banks support, as well as fiscal stimulus. And meanwhile, Bitcoin has just continued to move from strength to strength. Here we can see its low of $3,967 back in March. Recent high confirmed above $25,000 and is now trading above $25,000 as we speak. It therefore seems to make a lot more sense to actually look at Bitcoin on a log chart, as I've done here. And so we can see that actually, you know, the price extensions don't become too extorted from where they currently are, because there still seems to be an enormous amount of momentum, an enormous amount of enthusiasm to what Bitcoin potentially could offer. Of course, it's not everyone's cup of tea, and I understand that fully. And so while it's been a great year for Bitcoin, the same can't quite be said for Ripple, and particularly in this last week, where the price has been badly hit following the SEC's announcement that they believe XRP, the Ripple currency, is a security. Now, as a consequence of this, there has been a dramatic fall in the price of Ripple, where it was trading at around 55 cents. Nevertheless, its chief executive has come out fighting, claiming that XRP is not an investment contract. Ultimately, what this really shows to me is the power and importance of being a decentralized asset, because it really has seen for quite some time that XRP is that potential bridge currency for domestic currencies, which could be used globally, almost as a global payment system. And so this is a massive, massive development for a firm that is a partner of the World Economic Forum. And so what about the potential for short-term uncertainty? Well, that uncertainty could possibly happen when it comes to the notion of a contested election, as we can see here in this graphic. Now, it seems as if the chances are somewhat slim of anything other than a Biden victory, but we shall have to see, because anything else is not priced into the market. So should anything else happen, it is likely to result in big falls, potentially for all markets. And so really, you've got to make your decisions according to what you think is the most likely outcome. And so this possibility could actually cause some disruption to markets in the shorter term if anything unforeseen was to happen, because that's certainly not been priced into markets as things stand. And so big trends looking ahead. Well, of course, commodities. We know how undervalued commodities currently are, and we can see that against stocks here with the S&P 500. This is going to continue to be a big theme at this channel as we look at gold and silver, as well as other commodities and the upside potential that we can see there. Now, moreover, it's also about this fourth industrial revolution that Klaus has told us about. And this is actually a big, big opportunity, an opportunity for those that are aware that these trends are fully underway. And so for those that are actually aware of the businesses that are most likely to benefit over the coming years and even decade, as we see these clear trends really take hold. So there's going to be some big opportunities which we'll be discussing on the channel as we move forward. Now, in addition to that, three key themes that seem relatively obvious here, and that is the likelihood of the risk-on atmosphere maintaining itself. But will there be a renewed trigger event? Well, very, very difficult to say. We're also likely to see this progressive weakening in the dollar until or unless some sort of catalyst emerges upon which we can expect a big dollar spike to take place. And of course, we're going to continue to see deficits, debt, and debasement to add significant momentum to metals prices, as well as the prices of cryptocurrencies as well. And this is going to start to really generate price inflation among many of those commodities. And we're already starting to see the beginning stages of this. And this is all going to come. Now, I'd just love to finish off by saying thanks so much for all your support this year. Wish you and your families a very, very Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. I really hope you're having a great time there. Do let me know your thoughts as ever, and I look forward to hearing from you. Bye-bye.